Okay, I'm trying to share the screen. My screen on the other. Share. नजर आ रहा है आपको?
Yes, ma'am.
आप जानते हैं ना कि कल भी क्लास है?
जी मैम.
ओके, सो आज हम ड्राइंग ऑफ मिल्क लेंगे एंड हम आज थोड़ा सा ओवरव्यू लेंगे. Drying of milk जो techniques हैं, we have studied them in you have studied them in your UG part as well and masters as well. So today I'll just give you a brief of it, and then you must be having Sukumar Day with you and or any other book soft copy.
No, ma'am, I haven't.
Can you speak a bit louder? I can't hear you.
I don't have, ma'am.
Don't have any book?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so thing is what should I say? You should go through books, otherwise you'll not be able to do anything, na? Just a minute, hold on. Hello. हाँ सर बोलो सर हमें क्लास नहीं थी. हाँ सर आप हाँ अपने कॉल बैक करो. यस यस ओके. So the thing is that today I'll give you a brief on drying methods of milk, okay?
Okay.
Drying method as a whole, and then you will study a bit. You have to study a bit. I have a soft copy of some other book. I'll send you that. You read from that, and then tomorrow we teach in every drying process at a time. Ready? Okay. Clear to you? English mein problem ho rahi hai, then I can also switch on the language. If you have a problem with that.
No, ma'am, no.
It's fine.
This is okay, ma'am.
Okay. So first, we'll talk about what are dried products. Okay? So, anything which can, from which moisture has been removed cannot be stated as a dry product. Okay? So, a product is said to be dried if and only if, when we mix it with water or when we moisturize it, it resembles the original product. Okay? If it does not, then the dried product is not of much use, especially in case of liquid products like milk or any liquid curry or any related thing like that. Okay, so in case of milk especially, because we have milk into consideration, or we'll take milk into consideration for this unit. So products which when recombined with water gives little or no evidence of detrimental changes when compared to original liquid product. Is that clear? That detrimental changes like separation of fat or settling down of solids, these are detrimental changes which are unacceptable in the final finished or rehydrated product. Okay, so for milk we'll take dry product only when we add water or impart moisture into the dried substance or into the dried product, and it resembles similar to the liquid product, not having any kind of evident detrimental change. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so now we'll come that what is the purpose of drying any product. So when it comes to any product, say it's fruits and vegetables, say it's milk in organized farms, because in organized farms what the owner tries to do is that he wants to keep a continuous, or I should say a regularized schedule for like milking, drying of animals, like that. So there is always a period when there is excessive production, that is known as a flush season, and there is always a time when there is a lean season, there is less production. So what happens is that the production in the farm, say it is in case of fruits and vegetables, say it's in case of milk, the production is always like increasing or decreasing. Okay, so there is always a flush season and a lean season. Now, depending upon the availability of the product, the price of a commodity is determined. So when it's flush season, what will happen? The income will reduce, and when there is lean season, the income will increase because the rate of the product will increase. So in order to decrease this up and down or this movement in price and availability, what we do is that when there is excessive production, we store that particular object by drying it. Okay? And when it's lean period, we then convert that dried product into a normal liquid product and then we sell it, so that there is price maintenance throughout the year. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. As I have written, purpose, utilization of the product in flush season, when the product is present in excessive amount, that is a flush season, where the when the rate of production or when the amount of production is more than the rate of or amount of consumption, that is the flush season. And consistent supply in the lean season. Lean season is the season when the amount of production is less and the amount of production consumption is more. So that is the lean season. So the product is utilized properly and hence the price is maintained throughout the year. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is the aim and objective of having a dried product. Now, why do we actually need dried milk? Because we'll talk about milk only here, that's why. So what the first point is that it increases shelf life. Shelf life, how we increase? We all know that moisture is the main deteriorating agent when it comes to any food product. Because moisture is high, the bacterial attack or the fungal attack, it is more in ambient temperature. Okay, so when moisture content is high, obviously shelf life will be reduced. It will see more deteriorative changes. So what happens that when we reduce the moisture content, when we dry milk, what happens is the moisture content is drastically reduced. It is reduced to a level of less than 5%. Okay. So obviously the shelf life of the object will increase. And since the shelf life is increasing and the moisture is being reduced, the stability of the product will also increase. Because the fats and the proteins and the other solid substances will become more stable in presence of less moisture. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Then is the second point, proper utilization of the fresh season. That this I have discussed to you in the previous slide, that how we can properly utilize the product in the flush season and use that product to fulfill the requirements in the lean season. That is clear? Did I go a little slower? Are you able to understand?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Did I go slower? It's fine with you. Hello?
It's okay, ma'am.
Okay,
yes, ma'am.
Now for proper utilization of product during flush and lean season, that is clear to you, right? Okay. Then comes the third point, maintain product cost throughout the year. So when we have a consistent supply of the product throughout the year, what will happen that the price of the commodity will be on a normal level, will be kind of fixed, because the product is available throughout the year, hence the price is fixed throughout the year. So it is not a shock to the consumer as well as the seller. Okay? Clear? Mm-hmm. This point is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then fourth point, that is e-storage and transport. So what happens that when the amount of moisture is reduced, so what will happen? The bulk of the commodity will reduce, right?
Yes, ma'am.
When the bulk will reduce and the volume will also reduce, because if you dry a liquid substance, what happens? The volume reduces because moisture goes out. So the product is compact now, bulkier and compact. So what happens is it is easier to store. So we can store it in cardboard boxes or metal or galvanized tin cans. We can do that, right? And since we can pack it in a compact state, we can easily also transport it. Because the volume is reduced, so the transportation becomes easier. Is this clear?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
And the last point is increasing based on versatility. Versatility means we can use a dried product in more better ways as compared to the fresh liquid product. For example, if we go for making of cookies or cakes, instead of using liquid milk, if we want to increase the sweetness or if we want to increase the what should I say, the milky flavor of the substance, and but at the same time maintain moisture content of the product, then these powders play a very important role. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
5 points are clear that what is the main objective of preparing dry milk or drying milk. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
We'll move to the next slide. So what basically dried milks are? So dried milks are the product obtained by removing water or moisture from milk by heat or any other suitable means. So drying is mostly by either freeze drying, that is drying under freeze conditions, or by heating. Okay, these are the only two methods of taking out moisture. So we take out moisture from whole milk to a level of 5% or less. Okay. So what happens that when moisture is totally removed, to the extent of 95% or more from fresh milk, then the product obtained is dried milk. And this removal of moisture is either done by freezing or by heating, which we'll discuss in the coming slides. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So dried milk is of different, is of two types basically, depending upon the original product which is being dried. So it can either be whole milk or skimmed milk. Okay. So when it comes to dried whole milk or dried whole milk powder, which is WMP, we abbreviate as WMP, or it comes out to be dried skim milk, skim milk powder, or non-fat dry milk, that is used for skim milk. So in case of WMP, the basic constituent is whole milk. It can be either cow, buffalo, a combination of both, or reconstituted. Okay, these are the sources. Whereas for skim milk, the milk has to be skim milk of either buffalo or cow, or a mixture of buffalo and cow. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now we come for a dried milk. And what? And dried milk, and dried milk according to PFA rules 1976. The basic definition. Dried milk. So the first we'll discuss what is whole milk powder, WMP. It is the product obtained from cow or buffalo milk or a combination of both, or from standardized milk by removal of water. So for drying milk, it is obvious that water removal is to be done. Okay? It may contain calcium or phosphoric acids of sodium citrate, sodium salts, sodium salts of orthophosphoric acid, polyphosphoric acid, not exceeding the finished product by 0.3%. Okay. Now, since dried milk, whole milk powder has fat in it, hence an additional component, that is 0.01% of butylated hydroxyanisole by weight of the finished product, is also added. This is one of the differences. In skim milk powder, since the fat percentage is very low, hence 0.01% of butylated hydroxyanisole is not added. Whereas in WMP, whole milk powder, it is added. Is this clear? Okay. So now, whatever is the constituent, that 0.3% of these acids, calcium chloride and orthophosphoric, polyphosphoric acid, sodium citrate, all these are present, it could be labeled on the jar or on the container which is carrying this product. Okay? Is this clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Additions need to be on the label. Okay. Next line is, milk powder should not contain more than 5% of moisture and not less than 26% of fat. Okay? Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
That
needs
to contain a maximum of 5% moisture and a minimum of 26% fat. These are standards as per PFA rules 1976. Okay, the total acid of the product as expressed as lactic acid should not be more than 1.2%. The standard plate count should not exceed more than 50,000 per gram, and the coliform count should not exceed more than 90 per gram. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, depending upon the method used for drying the milk, solubility index is determined. So if the dried milk is obtained by roller drying technique, then the solubility index should be 15. But if it is obtained from spray dried technique, then the solubility index should be 2. Clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Now, one more important thing is that if you package the whole milk powder, okay? So if the package is less than 510 grams, then we can go for polyethylene lined cardboard boxes if it is less than 510 grams. But as soon as the weight of the product exceeds 510 grams, then the spray dried product, especially the spray dried product, should be hermetically sealed in containers. Hermetically sealed means it should be sealed in vacuum. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Dried whole milk powder is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So then comes skimmed milk powder. So as the name suggests, it is obtained from skimmed milk of cow, buffalo, or a combination of both by removal of water. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
It may contain calcium chloride or citric acid, as previously we discussed, or sodium salts it may contain calcium chloride, citric acid, or sodium citrate, and sodium salts of orthophosphoric and polyphosphoric acids. Okay, the maximum extent of this can be 0.3% by weight, and since it does not have fat, butylated hydroxy anisole is not required. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Similarly, as the whole milk powder was there, even in case of skimmed milk powder, whatever additional products we are adding to the main dried component, that is the skimmed milk powder, those need to be declared on the label present over the package. That is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
As we have read that in whole milk powder, what was the limit? Maximum of 5% moisture and minimum of 26% fat. But whereas in case of skimmed milk powder, it should be maximum of 5% moisture and maximum of 1.5% of fat. Okay? Clear?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, similar to whole milk powder, the total acidity expressed as lactic acid should not be more than 1.5%. Okay? The standard plate count should not exceed more than 50,000 per gram, and the coliform count should not exceed more than 90 per gram. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Whole milk powder, the solubility index in case of roller dried milk powder should be 15, and in case of spray dried milk powder should be 2. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
The packaging technique based on weight remains the same as whole milk powder. When it is less than 510 grams, hermetically sealed containers are not required, but when it's more than 510 grams, hermetically sealed containers are required. Clear? Any confusion in this slide?
No, ma'am.
Now, there are milk drying systems. Like, how will we dry the whole hydrated product, the whole milk product or the skimmed milk? How will we dry it so that we get whole milk powder or skimmed milk powder? Is this clear? So,
yes, ma'am.
Drying is either done by cold or by heat, by application of cold or by application of heat, because the moisture needs to be removed. So, when we use the cold technique, there are two basic methods. First is freezing out of water and then centrifugation. So what happens? The water and the whole and the remaining solids, they separate, and then the solid part is taken as whole milk powder, skim milk powder. Now this method is obsolete. It is no more practiced. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then comes freezing of milk and sublimation. So what we do in freezing of milk and sublimation is that we first freeze the milk and then we heat it so that the moisture does not change into a liquid state, rather it evaporates directly. Sublimation mein kya hota hai? कि any product is converted from solid to directly
gas.
Similarly, here what we'll do, we'll freeze the milk, and the moisture content of the milk will be then sublimated directly. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Heating up. We have two basic techniques. One is the roller, the film roller or drum drying technique, or the spray dry. Now, in the film roller or drum drying technique, what happens is we either do under normal atmospheric condition or we do it under vacuum. Clear? And second, the spray drying technique, either compressed air technique, pressure spray technique, or centrifugal technique. Okay. So these will be discussed in the coming lectures one by one in detail. Okay.
Okay.
So move to the next slide, that is freezing of milk and sublimation. Till the previous slide, that is this flow chart. Is there any form of confusion?
No, ma'am.
So what I'll do is I'll send you the soft copy of Sukumar Day. We touch the topic just one by one. Then
yes, ma'am.
Every day we'll take one drying method at a time. Okay. But for that you have to read the subject. You have to read the material so that we'll be able to take up.
Okay.
One more point I would like to add, that one difference between whole milk powder and skim milk powder is that the total ash content in whole milk powder is 7.3%, whereas in case of skim milk powder, 9.3%.
Okay.
So then we come to freezing and sublimation. Now I had talked about freezing and sublimation. Sublimation is the process where the liquid content is, where a solid is directly converted into gaseous state. So what we do in sublimation is that we first freeze the milk. We convert it into solid state. And then by supplying heat, we remove the moisture by the process of sublimation. So what is left is the milk powder, the solid part only. Okay? Clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Then comes the film roller or drum drying technique. Okay. So what happens is that in this technique, a thin film of concentrated milk is applied upon the smooth roller surface. Now this roller is made up of either steel, alloy steel, stainless steel, cast iron, and chrome and nickel plated steel. Okay, these are the materials used for making the dryer, drum, which is used for drying. Okay, now what happens is that this drum is heated to a temperature of 150 degrees centigrade with the help of steam. And concentrated milk is then poured over this rotating drum. Now, this milk is poured in, this milk comes in contact with the drum. It forms a thin film. But the contact surface, just a minute. But the contact surface, okay, the drum rotates at 14 to 19 RPM and it should, it comes in contact with the drum for hardly 3 seconds. Okay. And within these 3 seconds, the drum should rotate at the speed of 14 to 19 revolutions per minute in a way that during a single revolution, that is during this 3 seconds, 3/4 to 7 or 7/8 part of the drum is covered by the milk. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, this thin layer of milk is scraped off by a knife, which is placed at an angle of 15 to 30 degrees, okay, to the surface of the drum. And the whole thin film is then removed from the drum, and this film is then made into powder. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, in the next lecture, we'll discuss this whole technique in detail. You'll read it on your end, and then we will discuss it. Clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Now, the thing is that why do we concentrate the milk before pouring it on the drum? So it is concentrated so that it contains 16% to 18% of total solids, and concentration is done so that the film which is made on the roller is thick, and whatever heat we are producing that to maintain the temperature of the roller at 150 degrees centigrade, that is properly utilized. So it becomes economically effective. Okay? And the bulk density as well as keeping quality of the milk powder obtained from concentrated milk is better. Clear? Okay. So film, roller or drum drying is clear. Then we'll come to spray drying. Spray drying, there is one process known as atomization. Okay, atomizing. So what happens in atomizing is that the particles are reduced to that. First of all, the milk is sprayed through a nozzle, okay, into fine droplets which resemble fog or mist, okay. Those droplets are of the size 50 to 150 microns. These particles are then exposed to high temperatures in vacuum sealed containers, which is around 150 to 260 degrees centigrade. Okay, due to this high temperature, what happens is from those particles, moisture evaporates and the powder falls down on the surface. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is the basic principle. All these three techniques, compressed air, pressure spray, and centrifugal discs, we'll discuss later in coming lectures. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Spray drying, what is important is the process of atomization, the process in which milk is flushed out or pumped out from a nozzle under high pressure. The pressure is from 1500 to 5000 psi into a heated chamber with 150 degrees to 260 degrees at temperature. Okay, so the small particles are flushed out from the nozzle. They vary from size of 50 to 150 microns. Yeah. Okay. Then comes foam.
Okay.
What happens in foam spray drying is that we use this technique for drying whole milk or skim milk, as well as milk products and byproducts, such as buttermilk, sweet cream, sour cream, whey, and even emulsified cheese and slurries. We use the technique of foam spray drying in drying these products. Okay. Now what happens is that when the milk is pumped and atomized, in between that step, you can see there is one step known as forcing inert gas into liquid. So we first put the milk in a pump, then we mix that milk or that product with gas. Now air is commonly added as a gas for sprayed non-fat dried milk, that is for skimmed milk, air is used. Okay. And for making WMP, whole milk powder, we use nitrogen gas. Clear? So with,
yes,
we put milk inside the instrument, then at the level of pump, before it is atomized, the milk is either mixed with nitrogen or proper air, whichever product we aim for. Then it is atomized, that is small particles are made. Then those particles are dried in a chamber which is at 150 to 260 degree centigrade. Okay, and then the dried product is obtained. Clear?
Yes.
So by foam spray drying technique, the particles obtained are more uniform in size as compared to spray drying technique. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now comes, there are two points. What one is instantaneity and agglomeration. What is instantiation is that the product which we obtain, we instantly convert a dry product into a liquid product by addition of moisture. That is instantiation. Instantaneously, we convert a dry product into a liquid product. Clear?
Yeah.
Huh? A process by which dried milk products are instantaneously converted into soluble products, into liquid products. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Then comes agglomeration. Agglomeration, what we do? We increase the particle size. So first, what we'll do that we'll use condensed milk, atomize it, then spray it into a heated chamber to convert it into dried milk particles. Okay? Then we'll again use those dried milk particles and we recoat it with milk drops, and then we'll again dry it. So what happens? There is one milk particle, then a dried milk particle, then we coat it again with milk, then we dry it again. So the particle size slowly increases. There is agglomeration. So this process is known as agglomeration. The process of increasing the particle size by repeatedly recoating it with whole milk or milk, liquid milk. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So this finishes today's lecture. Do you have any questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So I'll stop the recording now.